morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Thank you so much for coming. I'm really happy to see all of you here today. I'm Jennifer Talley. I'm an assistant professor here at the New School. I am also the assistant director of the Center for Optimal Living, which is an outpatient psychotherapy practice based on principles of integrative harm reduction psychotherapy. We also have an integrative harm reduction psychotherapy certificate program here at the New School. If you want more information about that, you just have to go to newschool.edu/harm reduction and email me, ask some questions. I'm happy to tell you more about that. A little bit of housekeeping, so just so you know, the bathrooms are out and over to the left. We have food and snacks out through those double doors and over to the right. If you have cell phones, please make sure they're on silent. We also gave everybody recommendation forms. When they came in, we'll also be handing them out again at lunch. So one of our aims in hosting this event today is to be able to offer a series of recommendations for policymakers, researchers, and service providers, really based on what we discussed today. And we really want to hear from you and hope that you fill out the forms and give us your recommendations. One of the main reasons I wanted to get involved with this event not only was the work with Julie Netherland again and her amazing team, but I think it's really important for us to have these forums and the space to talk about the narrative in our culture about drug users. And it's really time for us to change the narrative and to change the paradigm around which we think about substance users, the way we approach treatment and policy. So I'm thrilled to be a part of this and really proud to be here right now. So with that, I'm going to hand it off to Julie.
Good morning. How's everybody doing?
Good morning.
All right. How many people were with us last night? I just want to get a sense. Excellent. And you managed to make it here this morning. So thank you. My name is Julie Netherland. I work at the Drug Policy Alliance. I'm the director of the Office of Academic Engagement. For those of you who may not be familiar with the Drug Policy Alliance, we're a national organization working to end the war on drugs. Seeking to shift our policies away from a criminal justice approach towards one grounded in public health, human rights, and compassion. Very delighted to be co-hosting this event with the New School and with John Jay. And I just want to take a moment for some quick thank yous before we get to our fabulous program today. I especially want to thank our sponsors, John and Maura Arnold, the Center for Motivation and Change, the Center for Optimal Living, Families for Sensible Drug Policy, the New York State Psychological Association's Division on Agenda. We also have a number of really fabulous partners that are listed behind me. Many are represented in the room, and this event would not have been possible without their help and assistance. So please just join me in thanking our partners and sponsors. Also want to give a special thanks to the many DPA colleagues that made this possible and helped with the planning of this event. There are too many to name, but let me just mention a few people that were really instrumental. Grant Smith, Stephanie Jones, Cassandra Frederick, and the team of the New York Policy Office, Jake Davies, Morgan Humphreys, Jim Clapes, Melissa Frankie, and many, many, many others. So I just want to take a minute to talk about what you can expect today. Last night, we had a really rich conversation about why people use drugs and how their life circumstances and lived experiences, as well as factors like gender and race, affect not only their use, but how their use is responded to and the kinds of policy interventions that we craft in response to drug use. We learned that there are many varied motivations for people to use drugs. We learned that the current approaches to handling novel psychoactive substances, especially criminalization and prohibition, are making the problem worse, not better. We learned that certain users are being stigmatized and pathologized in ways that make it even harder for them to get the help they may need, while others are able to use with relative impunity. We learned that a lot of factors affect drug use and our responses to it, and that if we really want to address problematic drug use, we're going to need a broad public health approach that accounts for a lot of more deep social determinants or social factors. We also learned that drug use and our drug policies, especially policing, often has nothing to do with drug use, but has to do with racism, poverty, mental health, homelessness, and housing issues. And I think most of all we learned that there's a lot we still don't know about these new psychoactive substances. And I think some of the problems that we're seeing emerge around NPS, or novel psychoactive substances, can really be a cautionary tale for us about what happens when we act with insufficient information, when we lead with fear, when we fall into old patterns of stigma and racist scapegoating, and when we enact policies without thoughtfully considering the research, and more importantly, I think, involving those directly impacted as being at the center of crafting our policies and our responses. So today, keeping in mind last night's conversation and what we learned there, we're going to work on trying to resolve some of those problems that we identified. So today what we want to do is focus on new solutions, solutions that are grounded in research and compassion, and most importantly, the lived experiences of people who use drugs. So just to give you a little highlight of things to come, on the first panel, we're really going to try to get some facts out. What do we actually know about these substances and who uses them? What don't we know? Where are there gaps, and where do we need to find more research? And what are the gaps between what the research says and what people on the ground in the field are seeing and experiencing? That's our first panel. The second panel is really going to focus on what should we do about novel psychoactive substances. Both what should we do in the short term to advance responsible use and prevent harmful use, but also how can we intervene to help people who may be struggling with these substances? What's been tried in other parts of the world? We're very fortunate to have some speakers from the UK here to share those experiences. And then what about at the policy level? Can we conceptualize productive responses other than prohibition and criminalization, ones that advance harm reduction and public health? And what would those concretely look like? So that's a conversation we're hoping to have at our second panel right after lunch. And then finally, our third panel, we're going to turn to media and messaging. And this is a really important issue that I think doesn't get discussed enough. But the way we talk about these substances and the people who use them matters. There's a long history of drug scares in this country, ranging from the so-called Negro cocaine fiend of the 1900s to the crack baby of the 1980s. And let me think, to the K2 zombies of last summer, right? So this is not new, but it is pernicious. And these messages have very real impacts, as we'll hear this afternoon. They can spread misinformation that puts people who use drugs and others at risk. They can drive policy, and they certainly can contribute to stigma, making it hard for people to reach out for help. So we'll be talking about how to do media messaging more effectively and more responsibly later this afternoon. And then finally, for our final panel, we're going to synthesize what we learned last night and today and really focus on recommendations going forward. If we want to do this differently, what does that look like? You should have received a form for you to also jot down your own recommendations, and we can hand those out after lunch again, because what we want to do is take the recommendations and solutions that come out of the conversation with the panelists and all of you to advance a document that we can then share with policymakers, media providers, and people who care about people who use drugs. So I think that this is a really opportune moment to be looking for new solutions, not just for novel psychoactive substances, but how we approach drug policy in general. I think, said this last night, there's a growing consensus that the war on drugs has failed. But the question, I think, before us today is, can we envision together a new approach? One that is grounded in public health and not punishment, one that doesn't demonize or stigmatize people who use drugs, but instead puts them at the center of solutions. I think we can do that, but I think it's going to take all of us working together, and so I'm very happy that what we've done today is pull together researchers, policymakers, people from the media, people doing service provision and harm reduction, as well as those directly impacted. So with that, I think we should get to work. This is an ambitious agenda that we set out for ourselves. For those of you who have been able to get online, I encourage you to live tweet the event using our hashtag, which is right here. And I'm now going to turn it over to the fabulous, always, Lisa Aguilera, the co-executive director of Vocal New York, who will introduce and moderate our first panel.
Thank you, Cassandra Frederick. So good morning, everybody. We have a wonderful panel of experts. experts, of doctors, of researchers, of outreach workers that are really going to lead us off with a common understanding of what NPS really are. I think that, you know, a lot of Julie's opening remarks about the myths and the stigma and the hysteria being really counterproductive to enacting good public policy and drug policy in our cities and country is right on. So we wanted to make sure that, you know, we're all coming here with a common understanding, using the most cutting edge research, the people who are really on the streets to help inform us of the facts. So without further ado, I'm going to bring our panelists up, so you can see all their bios in the program. But quickly, we'll bring up Dr. Joseph Palomar, who is the assistant professor of the Department of Population Health at NYU. Welcome. Michelle Nolan, who is an epidemiologist at the New York City Department of Health and Mental Hygiene. It's like the Price is Right, I think. Terrell Jones, come on up, Outreach and Advocacy Program Manager at New York Harm Reduction Educators. Dr. Lewis Nelson, the professor of at New York University School of Medicine and director of Fellowship in Medical Toxicology, New York City Poison Control Center.
All right.
And Adriana Joseph, who's a research technician at the NPS Institute for Psychiatric Research.
Welcome.
Let's see. All right. So, you know, right after you sat down, I'm going to ask you to come back up. So Dr. Nelson is going to kick us off, and he's going to really provide a general overview of what NPS are, the facts, and get us to that common understanding so we're all having this rich conversation from the same foundation.
Thanks for the invitation, the introduction. I love the energy in the room. It's really just wonderful. So I guess I'm the clinician here to talk a bit about what we see when we take care of people who've used these substances. And my role, just so you know, I'm a emergency physician. I work at Bellevue Hospital. So, you know, we're kind of the catchment for many patients from around the city who have both acute problems with drug use, requiring them to be seen in an emergency department, as well as many of the psychiatric complications of drug use. So you know, I have a broad perspective on a lot of these issues, but to be clear, I'm in awe many ways of the people here who work in the fields of public health and public policy, who have their boots to the ground and taking care of patients or people who are using these substances out there and really trying to make a difference in their life. I mean, I'm the kind of the end of the line for many of these patients, or sometimes the bump in the road in their course of life. And I deal a lot, of course, with overdose and addiction and dependence and even death from many of these substances. So what I'm going to try to do today, and get the slides to move, is just go over some of the issues that we deal with on a regular basis. To probably put a little clinical context to some of the drugs we're going to be talking about as we go on. Many people know that these drugs are widely used at festivals and places like that. And just recently in New York City, there were a few deaths leading to the cancellation of a concert not very long ago, just a few weeks ago in Argentina. Same sort of problem, largely related in these cases to the stimulant psychoactive drugs, which are widely used at electronic music festivals and other places. I want to just show you a structure. I know many people hate chemistry, but I think it helps to understand a tiny bit about what amphetamines are, because it'll go through a little bit more about what other drugs that we're commonly seeing today are. So you'll see on the screen left, where's that screen right? I can't tell. Screen right, right? Yeah, my left. Your face is on the left side. I have time zone problems too, the way my brain works. So I just wanted to make it clear that there are two big class amphetamine drugs that people talk about. Right? There are the amphetamines proper, like methamphetamine, which are typically considered to be speedy drugs. Right? They make you wired, they make your heart race, they make your blood pressure go up, they make you sweat, they make you agitated, they can lead to psychosis and real stimulant-related problems. And then there are the amphetamines like ecstasy or methylene dioxymethamphetamine, which is a mouthful, we just say MDMA or just ecstasy, which are considered trippy. Right? They have a very different clinical profile than amphetamines proper. Right? And you can see the reason. They have that substituent on the end of the molecule that really changes all of the chemical properties and the way that drug interacts with your brain. Even though they share the same backbone, as you can see, a phenylethylamine, One of them produces an agitated sort of delirium. The other one produces a much more mellow, introspective, people say entactogenic, reaching within sort of feelings associated with loving and kissing and hugging and that sort of thing, which is not something you would associate with methamphetamine typically. That's a bit more in the way of an agitated sort of rage. Like you see here, pretty well demonstrated. So the methamphetamine persona versus the ecstasy one. Right? And they really are very telling when you see people that look like this. Now, MDMA, of course, as I said, has now been studied or is intended to be studied to be used to improve a psychiatrist's ability to interact with a person's past and present emotional state by allowing them to sort of touch inside or reach within their history. These would be ecstasy pills you buy on the street, right? And really what we now see, as much as we see ecstasy pills, which are basically stamped in a pill press, is we see Molly, right, which was marketed a few years ago as an alternative or an improvement on ecstasy, but you realize, of course, that the contents that they contain conceptually are exactly the same. They're both MDMA. Molly's typically sold as a powder or in these sorts of capsules, as opposed to being sold in a pill, but there are no rules. And the fact is that neither one is more pure than either of the others. And here's just some nice data to show you that you can actually find online at this website where you can send a pill in and they will analyze using advanced analytic technology and they'll produce online the results of what they found. And just to show you an example, here's an ecstasy tablet that contains no or very little MDMA compared to others, and some contain none at all. It contains phentermine, which is amphetamine. You never really know what you're buying. It's somewhat dangerous. Quality control is very lacking in these pills. Remember, these are made by me in my basement. Right? They're not made by Pfizer or Merck, and they're not marketed in that way. They're sold by somebody you don't really know, particularly when you're getting these things that are either stamped in a pill press or put into a little baggie. This one that I showed up there contains 2CB, which is a very potent amphetamine. And that's a problem, because if you're used to taking a pill with a certain amount of drug, and now the pill has a certain amount of drug, but it's a different drug that's a lot more potent, where instead of a milligram causing an effect, a microgram does, 1,000-fold less, you can easily see how you can overdose on these things and wind up to my emergency department, agitated with police in a body bag, perhaps, with an IV in your arm, getting sedated, right? Alternatively, here's another example of a pill which contains a chemical called alpha-PVP. Alpha-PVP is also known as flocka or gravel. It's what we sometimes call bath salts, right? Bath salts is a made-up name, just like ecstasy is a made-up name. People like the name bath salts because you can sell them in a little container in a store and not sell them as a drug you're going to use psychoactively. Because right? You can't do that. You can't sell a drug to be abused over the counter in a store. But you can sell bath salts, incense, and things like that. And that's how they tend to get away with these things. Alpha-PVP, if you look at the chemical structure, you can see it's got that phenylethylamine backbone. But it's got that O with a double bond on it. That's very important because that makes it a cathinone. Bath salts are not amphetamines, they're cathinones. But if you look here, the corresponding amphetamines, methamphetamine and MDMA, have corresponding cathinones. Right? That's important because when we ban methamphetamine, that doesn't automatically ban mephedrone. Right? Mephedrone becomes legal for a while until we catch up to it and make it illegal. That allows it to be produced on the streets and sold to unsuspecting people. It's much cheaper, it's much more potent, it's much more dangerous. Right? These are the clinical effects I spoke about a minute ago. They're all particularly problematic in overdose. Of course, like with any drug, if you take the right dose, it might not be a problem. You can overdose on acetaminophen. You can overdose on water, right? You just have to take the right dose and you'll be fine. And this is where we start to see problems, is when these things are uncontrolled dosing. What you see, in a way, is not necessarily what you get. As I've kind of suggested, that these pills can contain anything and you never really know what's going to be in there. So what you see is what not necessarily what you get. And this is the problem with these sorts of drugs out there. And I kind of showed you before, when you get the pills analyzed, you never exactly know what you're going to find. Right? Again, it's a lack of quality control. What we also see a lot of is marijuana. Right? And now marijuana is not what it used to be when you were young, or maybe some of you are still young, but when I was young, right? Marijuana contained 3 or 4% THC, the active ingredient. You kind of knew what you were going to get when you smoked a joint or you smoked some pot. But now, because some of these products contain 20 or even 30% THC, what used to be a joint now comes down to being part of a single hit to get the same amount of THC into your body. Right? It's very hard to dose control. And we actually start seeing people coming to the ED for marijuana use, something we never used to see. And of course, there's all the alternatives that people talk about, like the synthetic cannabinoids. These sometimes are called synthetic marijuana, but don't fool yourself, they are completely different. You can buy these cute little packages, and they even look a little bit like marijuana when you pour them out, but they contain much different compounds. Just, and you don't have to look at the structures and memorize them, but just realize that THC in the top has some structural relationship to these other drugs. That's why they're sometimes called synthetic marijuana. Their clinical effects are completely different. Right? People who smoke pot get mellow and hungry. Right? People who use synthetic cannabinoids get wild and aggressive. Right? And we've seen these folks come in looking just like methamphetamine users, and while we don't see a lot of deaths caused by this, we do see a lot of people putting themselves in situations they probably don't want to be in. Again, like any other drug, if you use the right dose, you'll probably be okay, but since you don't know what you're getting, you have no idea what drug is in there, and you have no idea what dose it is. Right? Synthetic cannabinoids, as listed on here, are actually increasing in popularity by young student-age children. Right? They're changing all the time, right? In a way, once we create one and we legalize it, another one is created. We call this a pharmacologic game of whack-a-mole, where once you produce one, another one comes up as soon as you get rid of the original. It makes it very, very hard to practice clinical medicine because you never know what the person actually took, right? We think about the heroin and the cocaine epidemics of the early 80s and 90s as being problematic in terms of drug overdose, but I want you to realize that right now, if you took those two epidemics and added them together and doubled them, it would still be less number of deaths we have annually than from opioids that we see today, right? And as you can see here, just a few years ago, the number of deaths from opioids, which is listed as drug poisoning on the dark blue line, surpassed the number of people who died in the United States from both firearms and from motor vehicle crashes. An astounding feat when you really think about it. It is a big problem. And this is not all prescription drugs, it's not all heroin, it's a combination of both, but it is a problem, and heroin is really our rising star. Right? As bad as prescription drugs are, we seem to have leveled off in our mortality from those. But the amount of heroin now that's rising, of course, is quite concerning. It makes the headlines when you get people like Corey Monteith of Phillips Inner Hospital, much more recently, of course, Prince, dying of an opioid, right? But you realize that is the absolute tip of the iceberg. Those are the ones that bring it to public attention, and Sanjay Gupta talks about it on CNN, and everybody speaks a bit about it, but you don't realize that there are hundreds, there are thousands, there are tens of thousands of people dying every year from these drugs. And you can see the numbers up there, how it's sort of leveled off in the past few years in terms of the prescription opioids. We're seeing about 16 or 17 or even 18,000 deaths from that or so. And it's flat, but look at the numbers for heroin. Over the past few years, they've quadrupled in the numbers, and they're going to keep rising, as you can see on the bottom graphic. Right? And of course, heroin, if it wasn't bad enough, is now being replaced. Right? The quality control for heroin, which was always reasonably controlled, there was some variation in the content of potency by a small amount, is now being replaced by fentanyl and the fentanyl derivatives, which are hundreds and in some cases thousands of times more potent than heroin, meaning that pinhead amount could kill you. And you don't know what you're getting. And if you read the news and you look around the country, there are dozens or hundreds now of deaths a day in the United States and Canada from fentanyl and its derivatives. So summing it all up, I just want to leave you with this message. You never knew what you were getting to begin with, right? But now not knowing what you're getting is actually leading to serious consequences, like death, right? And that makes it a big problem. If we were able to control the dose, all of these drugs would conceivably be safe. They'd all still be addictive, but they wouldn't necessarily be life-threatening, right? Although most people don't die from these things, though, many people do, and it is a big problem. These are the people I see. It's not necessarily the people you see, but there is a relationship because often they do overlap. Anyway, I do want to mention finally that almost all the drugs I talked about today are undetectable in the hospital. Right? They're all detectable with advanced testing. Nothing can be found, right? But if you come into the emergency department and I check your urine or your blood, I can't find almost any of these things, right? which raises a lot of questions from a clinical and a public health perspective, and certainly work a lot with the medical examiner. Michelle and I do, working with the medical examiner, trying to figure out who's dying of what, and if they're not testing for it, if they can't find these things, it makes doing the epi very difficult. So I'll leave you with that, and I'm sure we'll have time on the panel. There he is. Thank you.
And next up, we're going to bring up Michelle Nolan, who is an epidemiologist here in New York City, and she's going to use the recent, issue of synthetic cannabinoids in New York City as a case study to walk us through some of the notes she's found as an epidemiologist and the impact it has on criminalization.
I'm going to be talking about synthetic cannabinoids and particularly using it as an opportunity to present almost a case study in how criminalization impacts both drug use as well as a public health response. So synthetic cannabinoids, we've covered this, act on the same receptors in your brain as marijuana, but have a vastly different chemical structure. And in New York City, they're typically referred to as K2. That encompass many different chemicals. And it's an interesting case study for thinking about our current drug policy, because what we observed was that criminalization of substances incentivized the use of potentially more risky substances, and also criminalization ultimately ended up limiting options for a public health response. And I'm going to discuss both of those points. So, criminal status of drugs, laws to criminalize drugs at both the federal, state, and local levels. Many drugs are criminalized, however, some drugs are more criminalized than others, is probably the easiest way of explaining that. For example, marijuana, it's criminalized under federal law everywhere, but as we know, there's varied enforcement. And then another drug, kratom, not criminalized under federal law, criminalized in 4 states, locally criminalized in 2 Florida counties, etc. It's a patchwork of drug laws that we're working with. For synthetic cannabinoids, there are several hundred of these compounds. 22 specific compounds are illegal under federal law. And then since then, some state and local jurisdictions have made compounds illegal. For example, in New York State, possession, sale, manufacture was a violation for state public health law starting in 2012. And then ultimately in New York City in December of 2015, sale of synthetic cannabinoids, not possession, not use, became a criminal offense. And as some of you may know, we monitor drug-related emergency department visits on a daily basis, and we also monitor K2-related ED visits. We receive data daily from 51 EDs in New York City, and this data is really useful to interpret trends, but we don't really describe it as an exact case count. And we began daily monitoring of K2-related emergency department visits in 2014. So just to give you a background with some data, in July of 2014, we noticed an increase. I swear there's an increase there. in case you can't quite see it, that's what we were able to pick up, was basically on one weekend, we identified a cluster of individuals who were transported from the hospital. And then simultaneously, our friends at the New York City homeless shelter called us and indicated that they were seeing the same thing. So as a result of this increase and then confirmation from our partners in the field, we issued a health alert and initiated a public health investigation. We conducted a field investigation as part of our public health response with the idea that we really wanted to understand the scope and the severity of what was going on and recommend some control measures. Anytime people are getting sick from something, that's something that raises some concern. This consisted of an epi investigation, qualitative interviews with individuals who had gotten sick, as well as some individuals who had treated them, as well as some laboratory analysis of the product. Ultimately, what we learned was that patients with a K2-related emergency department visit at this time were 90% male, median age was 37, and 99% were age 18 and older. I won't say that again. 99% were age 18 and older. This was not young kids. And then conducted a chart review of patients and identified that residents of shelters and individuals with a psychiatric illness were heavily represented among the population that ended up in the emergency department. And what I want to highlight at this point is we have really limited data on prevalence. We don't really understand or have good data in New York City specifically about who is using synthetic cannabinoids. What we can see is who is ultimately getting sick. And that's really what I'm talking about. Based on our interviews with individuals who had ended up at the emergency department, we asked them about their motivations for using, and they noted that it was really inexpensive compared to other substances. There was a strong desire to avoid a positive drug test. Many individuals actually indicated a preference for marijuana, and it was widely known that synthetic cannabinoids were not included in routine drug screen panels. It created this sort of perverse incentive where your desire to use a substance but not experience a lot of adverse events, particularly on the criminal side, incentivized you to use a more risky substance. Also, people noted that they did like some of the effects. They wanted to feel high, out of it, and calm. They were curious about a new drug that was available, and that it was easily accessible. As part of our investigation, we noted that there's spatial clustering of emergency department visits around stores that were suspected of selling synthetic cannabinoids. This was early in July 2014, or ultimately many more stores who were selling these products, but you can see how visits appeared to cluster around stores that we knew about. And one strategy to reduce harm associated with substances is to impact availability. And the goal is to really reduce the health consequences. And we do this with a number of different things. Alcohol is one of them. We impose age restrictions. We limit the hours of sale. We do licensing and taxation. Another example is trans fats. New York City regulated the use of trans fats by food service establishments, and ultimately people consumed less trans fats. But how do you impact availability, or how do you even try to avert adverse events in a criminalized context when your options are so severely limited? We couldn't regulate as the New York City local public health department. We couldn't say, like, these compounds are okay, these ones aren't. So we're stuck with this bit of a conundrum. So we looked at some options for reducing availability, and in 2014, sale of these products was a violation of the New York State public health law, which is technically distinct from a crime. And the Department of Health has the authority to declare products a public health nuisance and remove them from stores. We've done this with a couple of different things. But since products were illegal, we couldn't actually take them out of the store. There was concern about the health inspectors taking custody of products. Something that, if there was milk that was soiled or had spoiled in a store, we could take that out. But we couldn't take custody of illegal compounds. So consider law enforcement as an option, since they are experienced in taking custody of controlled substances and are legally permitted to do so. But there is limited enthusiasm for enforcing violations of public health law. The DEA is focused on large-scale distributors, and the New York City Law Department pursued nuisance actions against two stores, resulting in the product removal and store closure. It was incredibly time-consuming, and it took several months, and ultimately that was two stores. So in the meantime, pursued other public health responses that did not impact availability, so issued a press release, and this was the what our press release turned into when it got picked up by the media. Created some posters and some educational campaigns specifically directed at individuals who were currently using K2, and then issued a health advisory, another health advisory, and a third health advisory. And during that time, visits related to K2 continued to increase, bringing us to July of 2014, where we had more than 1,200 K2-related emergency department visits, which, if you think about a city in New York City, that's a lot on a daily basis. So ultimately, at sort of the peak of this, what was done was this multi-agency product removal effort where health commissioners' orders were served in heavily impacted neighborhoods, reminding store owners that, okay, these products are making people sick and you're prohibited from selling them. There is these multi-agency inspections and product removal efforts, which focused on neighborhoods that we're experiencing large numbers of emergency department visits, and this work began in July of 2015, and then there was a large enforcement action actually targeting more of the supply chain in September of 2015. So following this work, really working on trying to limit the availability of the compounds, emergency department visits decreased 85%. Actually, that holds true through March of 2015 as well. So in 2015, there were more than 6,800 emergency department related, more than 6,800 K2 related emergency department visits in New York City. These visits peaked in July of 2015 with more than 1,200 ED visits, and currently there are 85% fewer ED visits compared to the peak. However, these visits remain elevated compared to 2014. That's just an overview of the epidemiology and sort of New York's experience these particular compounds. But despite criminalization, many people continue to use psychoactive substances. This is not news to anyone in the room, but novel, uncontrolled psychoactive substances were used to reduce the risk of punitive action. However, there is increased health risk associated with these substances compared to a preferred substance, such as marijuana. And criminalization limited public health ability to both do some really crucial harm reduction work, as well as efforts to limit availability. Thank you. So
we wanted to start off with common understanding. Want to take a look into sort of how K2 in New York City, from an epidemiology perspective, you know, what the data shows. But now we wanted to bring up Dr. Joseph Palomar, who's going to talk a little bit about, you know, what people think they're taking, their trends in use, self-reported use, and some of the gaps. So thank you.
So I've been conducting drug research for about 15 years now. Really quickly, slightly interesting story. I was actually supposed to be a police officer. I was hired by the NYPD about 16 years ago. I just wasn't old enough to start yet. But by about that time, I started frequenting the after-hours nightclub scene in New York City. And I started hanging out with all these people who were drug users, and I started to see that all these people using drugs like ecstasy were usually just normal people, like any of us in this room. And a lot of them were engaging in risk behavior, and I got sick of my friends dying. I got sick of carrying unconscious bodies out of nightclubs because these were too much GHB or too much ecstasy. So I turned down the police job and I became a drug researcher. So I've been doing this for a while. So I dedicate most of my research to the nightclub and festival scenes, especially here in New York City. I have two current grants. So I have a 5-year grant, it's called a K award from the NIH. So I interview what we call key informants, people who specialize in use of novel psychoactive drugs, whether it be psychonauts, people who use a lot of these drugs, or drug checkers for people like DanceSafe and things like that. So people that can give me a lot of qualitative information. And I'm also funded to survey thousands of people outside of nightclubs and festivals throughout New York City about primarily about novel psychoactive drugs and what they think they're taking anyway. So most of what I study relates to what people believe they're taking or what people report they're taking. But as Dr. Nelson pointed out, that basically a lot of people think they're taking one thing, but they're taking something quite different. And I study prevalence and correlates of use. I don't focus very much on adverse outcomes as much as other people. I incorporate that a little bit into my research, but I'm more about prevalence and things like that to try and inform prevention and harm reduction, especially in the nightclub scene. So I'm just going to give you a very quick overview of some research I've conducted across the United States and here in New York City. So we don't know a lot about prevalence of use of novel psychoactive drugs throughout the U.S. as a whole. You could look at any Monitoring the Future or an SDUH report and see every year how many people, whether it's kids, adults, are using marijuana, crystal meth, ecstasy. But when it comes to the other drugs like bath salts, we generally don't know. There's only one national survey, it's called Monitoring the Future, they're in the news a lot. I analyze their data quite often, and they ask about two novel psychoactive drugs. They ask about what they call synthetic marijuana, which really, they mean synthetic cannabinoids, and they ask about bath salts. And bath salts is a bit of a vague term, and I'll return to that in a minute. So I've authored a couple of papers relating to what people report about these two drugs in monitoring the future. So in monitoring the future, in 2011, 12% of high school seniors said that they knowingly used synthetic cannabinoids. So 12% for a novel drug, that's a huge amount. It was either the first or second most prevalent drug, illicit drug used after marijuana. So it was used by a lot of people. Luckily, by 2015, last year, went down to 5%. So it went down a lot, and that's a good thing. What we found in my study was that 99.5% of synthetic cannabinoid users in the sample we looked at reported marijuana use. So I think we all know that a lot of people are using synthetic cannabinoids as a replacement, or attempting to use it as a replacement for marijuana. And we confirmed that. And also adjusting for a lot of other confounders, we found somewhat of a dose response association. The more marijuana people have used over time, the more likely they were to report synthetic cannabinoid use. So obviously, I think a lot of people, the heavier users, are trying to replace the marijuana, which they're at risk of being arrested for using, with synthetic cannabinoids. Now here's a problem with the US and in general. So rates of use have been going down. Well, that's a good thing. But the problem is poisonings have been increasing, especially in areas like here in New York City. So, I mean, what's going on? So either people are engaging in heavier use frequently, maybe they've become dependent on these drugs, so maybe it's a different type of use. Maybe it's a different type of user that's been using in these last couple of years. Because generally, if you identify as white or Caucasian, you're at higher risk of use of most drugs. But I think a lot of these people being poisoned tend to be black or Hispanic. So it might have to do with race, and that's, of course, related to marijuana laws. We recently co-authored a paper a couple months, or about a year ago, and we found that among poisonings related to synthetic cannabinoids here in New York City, the average age of the people being poisoned is actually increasing. So we have people being poisoned in their 30s on synthetic cannabinoids here in New York City. And that makes me think a little bit about policy. So when you hear arguments against marijuana legalization, the common argument is we're worried about the developing brain of kids and teens, but now their parents are being poisoned on legal synthetic cannabinoids. So now we have to worry, are the parents going to be poisoned? So we have to worry about the parents now and the kids. And what else is possibly different? Maybe the compounds are just getting stronger, or maybe different mixes of compounds. And that's why poisonings are going up, and yet prevalence is actually decreasing. My colleagues and I at Poison Control and at Columbia University are actually analyzing state-level synthetic cannabinoid poisoning data right now. And we're trying to determine whether local marijuana laws are related to rates of synthetic cannabinoid poisonings. And in the most simple statistical models we're looking at, we actually found that states that have decriminalized marijuana, the average age of those poisoned on synthetic cannabinoids are actually older. So there's something going on with age and marijuana law. Unfortunately, while we adjust for a bunch of other covariates, we start losing all of our findings. So we're trying to figure out what's going on there. But we think that there's an issue with regard to, we have more poisonings in New York City, D.C., and in Mississippi than anywhere in the U.S. As of 2014. So, and two of these areas have decriminalization or legalization. So there are problems with these analyses we're trying to work out now. Shifting a little bit to bath salts, which is a street name for synthetic cathinones. So nationally in the U.S., only 1% of high school teens say they've used bath salts or knowingly used bath salts. The problem is this monitoring the future, which assesses bath salt use, they don't specify drugs. They don't say, have you used methadone, have you used vodka? A lot of these kids think bath salts are simply, literally, salt you put in your bath. A lot of people think that. Or they think, well, I don't use drugs that turn me into a zombie, I don't eat people's faces off. People are not educated about any of this. And even in the club scene, people are not educated about bath salts at all. They don't know that methadone is a bath salt. So they'll tell me, yeah, I use methadone. I'm like, that's a bath salt. They're like, oh, okay. So people don't know what they're doing. And we're finding that really a lot of people are using bath salts unintentionally. So 1% is definitely an underestimate for bath salts in the U.S. and here in New York City. And this relates to something I think is really important, ecstasy, or now commonly called Molly. A lot of people don't know that Molly is or is supposed to be ecstasy or MDMA. In my opinion, Molly is actually our biggest NPS-related problem. It's really, Molly is the biggest delivery system of unintentional novel psychoactive substance use that has come around. A lot of people don't want to take these new drugs. They don't know they're taking them, or they're taking them by accident. And a lot of people never find out that they're taking them. So ecstasy has been really problematic. About 13% of young adults in the U.S. say they've used ecstasy in their lifetime. That's 4.5 million people. 5.5% of high school seniors say they've used ecstasy in their lifetime. I believe these are underestimates, because as we all see, there are more festival deaths than ever. People are dropping dead after taking what they call Molly more than ever. We have poisonings increasing in the U.S. over the last how many years. And we can see just popularity is increasing. Song lyrics, everything, I mean, and it's transcended into the hip-hop scene. Molly is very popular, yet why is the prevalence so low if it's so popular and we have all these poisonings? So what we actually found out, we have a paper that came out this week and we issued a press release this morning, hopefully we get some coverage. We found that the prevalence of ecstasy use among high school seniors goes up close to 3% when we include Molly in the definition. That means that a large proportion of ecstasy users are saying they've never used because they don't know that Molly is or is supposed to be ecstasy. So it's being, in my opinion, severely underreported. So I don't think rates of use of ecstasy are going down. I think they've stayed the same or possibly even increasing. And with regard to my nightclub study here in the city, 85% agree that ecstasy is Molly or should be Molly. 8% didn't know, and 7% actually disagree. I think they disagree. I think a lot of more educated drug users actually feel that Molly is just supposed to be a mystery powder, and it doesn't necessarily supposed to have MDMA in it. And about 30% of people I surveyed actually said that their Molly or ecstasy has contained a drug other than ecstasy. So people are self-reporting that they have tested their drug and found out that it's highly contaminated. And we collected hair samples from a portion of those we surveyed last summer. And out of people who said they only used ecstasy and didn't use any bath salts or unknown powders or anything like that, about 4 out of 10, their hair tested positive for novel psychoactive drugs, usually bath salts. So butylone was the most commonly found drug in their hair. So butylone is a potent bath salt. We found methylone, which feels a lot similar to ecstasy. And we actually found one case of flaca. One person used flaca without knowing it, and it probably came from her ecstasy. And we also found other novel psychoactive drugs in their hair. So, and we're also looking at prevalence and things like that, of rates they report. And I've been collaborating with my colleague Adam Winstock, who oversees the Global Drug Survey. You've heard of that. So we have a paper under re-review now, and almost half of the sample, of the U.S. sample, said that they've used at least one novel psychoactive drug. And about a third of my New York City sample said they've used. So right now I'm continuing to do my study. I'm working on different grants to continue hair testing. I want to apply for a grant to see if I can somehow get permission to actually test drugs outside of nightclubs without touching them. We've got to find out a legal loophole to be able to do something like that. So we're trying to continue our research, and that's that. And really quickly, if anyone here is an expert, whether you test drugs outside of clubs or you're a heavy NPS user yourself, I'm always looking to interview people. It's an anonymous interview. It pays $50. I can do it over the phone or in person, and because I'm looking for more great data from people who specialize in this stuff, and we can get your word out in the research. So that's pretty much it.
And our next panelist is Adriana Joseph, who is going to talk a little bit about more about trends in use, particularly among emerging populations that are using synthetic cannabinoids.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Adriana Joseph, and I'll be talking today about a study that was done in partnership with the Division of Social Solutions and Services Research at NPI and the Department of Psychiatry at NYU. So the name of our study was Social Demographic Characteristics Associated with Synthetic Cannabinoid Use Among Patients Treated in a Public Psychiatric Emergency Setting. So you pretty much get the whole study in a spiral. Background. So as we've pretty much been reviewing all morning, there's been thousands of synthetic cannabinoid-related ED visits in New York City. The literature that we reference has reported that synthetic cannabinoid use is really common among white younger males, generally in their the middle and late 20s. However, in New York City, there seems to be a little bit of difference in terms of the demographics of synthetic cannabinoid use. Mostly, we find that they're male, or racial and ethnic minorities, which is white or Hispanic men, and the median age is about 37. With these facts in mind, we wanted to further explore what were the socio-demographic characteristics of reported SC users who present to emergency psychiatric setting, particularly because we were interested in looking at the relationship between synthetic cannabinoid use, mental health, and psychiatric distress. So our method. So what we did is we did a retrospective chart review of patients who presented to the Bellevue Health Center's Comprehensive Psychiatric Emergency Program in November of 2012. So CPEPS, and a Comprehensive Psychiatric Emergency Program, is a statewide program that provides public hospitals an emergency psychiatric setting that is specifically staffed and has unique services that are just for cases in psychiatric distress. So our sample was derived from Bellevue CPEP. So inclusion criteria to be considered as a synthetic cannabinoid user was documentation of synthetic cannabinoid use in their charts, which covered the variety of the names that synthetic cannabinoid use is under on the streets, and that the use was within 2 weeks of CPAP admissions. So this resulted in 940 patients in our sample, which is quite robust. And data was collected from administrative and clinical databases. So the data that we collected was, of course, synthetic cannabinoid use, which is either from self-report or collateral source, which meant that a friend or a family member or a case manager was able to verify or to able to report that the patient had used synthetic cannabinoids. Of course, demographics, age, gender, race, ethnicity, housing status, domiciles, meaning that they had stable residence, or jail. There was only one patient or one participant that had that's permanent residence was jail at the time. Homeless or residing in a shelter. Our next variable that was collected was method of presentation. So how did the patient end up at CPEP? So either EMS, emergency medical services, or adult emergency services, New York City Police Department, the NYPD. So patients could have been brought in either under custody, meaning that they were arrested, at which time that they were brought into CPAP, or they were being brought in as an emotionally disturbed person, which means that they may have been under restraints, but they weren't under custody of the police. And of course, walk-in, so people were coming off the streets, or people were being referred from Bellevue's outpatient psychiatric department, and arrest status as well. So were they arrested? Were they under custody when they came into CPAP? So these are our results. So of our 948 sample, 110 reported synthetic cannabinoid use within 2 weeks of being admitted, and 838 did not. So what's bolded are the variables that had statistical significance, or there's statistical difference between the two groups. So males, among synthetic cannabinoid users, 95% of them were males, whereas among the non-synthetic cannabinoid users, only 75% were. 90% of synthetic cannabinoid users were non-white, whereas only 72 were among the non-synthetic cannabinoid users, and the age. So among our SC users, they were a bit younger, statistically significantly younger than the non-synthetic cannabinoid users. And then if we skip down to housing status, this is where we had some really interesting findings. So among those who said they used synthetic cannabinoids, 84% reported that they were even homeless or living in a shelter, whereas only 27% of their counterparts reported that they were homeless or living in a shelter. So here, clearly, there's something, as has been reviewed today, there's something going on among the homeless in New York City and their access and use of synthetic cannabinoids. So So we wanted to kind of continue to kind of quantify and understand what exactly is association between the characteristics that we collected and the propensity of self-reporting to the cannabinoid. So we generated a model where we could look at odds ratios, which can determine likelihood. And so what we find here is that males were almost 5.4 times more likely to report synthetic cannabinoid use. The way that you interpret age here is if age goes up, the likelihood of use goes down. So the older you are, the less likely you are to use synthetic cannabinoids. Non-whites were 2.7 times more likely to use synthetic cannabinoids. And the homeless, or if you're being homeless or residing in a shelter, you are almost 18 times more likely to use synthetic cannabinoids. And method of presentation, those who presented to CPEP either through EMS or the adult emergency services were less likely to report synthetic cannabinoid use. So those who are using synthetic cannabinoids are coming into CPEP differently. So these are kind of what we can take away from our study, which was quite preliminary, but still had some interesting findings. That being homeless or residing in a shelter was our most significant predictor of synthetic cannabinoid use. Like I said, they were 18 times more likely. Males are at a 5.4 times greater likelihood of using synthetic cannabinoids than women. Non-whites were 2.7 times more likely than whites. Younger individuals are more likely to use synthetic cannabinoids, and patients who reported synthetic cannabinoid use were less likely to present to CPEP through emergency services. So we wanted to kind of further understand the relationship between housing status, method of presentation, and together its effect on self-reported synthetic cannabinoid use. So we developed another model to look at interactions. However, this model didn't fit our data very well, so we didn't report in our paper, but it still came up with some interesting findings. So when you look at people who presented to CPEP by the NYPD and who were homeless, their likelihood of reporting synthetic cannabinoid use is 21.5%. Let me rephrase that. Their likelihood was 21.5% greater than those who were not brought in by the police or who were domiciled or who were living not in the shelter or not homeless. So there's definitely something going on between being homeless and being picked up by the police and being a synthetic cannabinoid user. So what we know. So there's an emerging population in New York City from what we can gather from our sample of homeless non-white males who are using synthetic cannabinoids. Because CPEP is specifically for patients who are undergoing some type of psychiatric distress, that we feel that there may be some psychiatric illness or mental health either preceding or following synthetic cannabinoid use, and that these people have high interactions with the police. Now, homeless non-white men and the mentally ill already have a high interaction with the police, but it seems that those who are using synthetic cannabinoids that may be exacerbating their interaction with the police, and it further lends itself to suggest that there needs to be considered public health interventions that engage all stakeholders in the community to really be able to prevent synthetic cannabinoid poisoning, as well as spread awareness, especially to the most marginalized and disenfranchised parts of the community, which are the homeless. So what we don't know. So unfortunately, since our study was cross-sectional, we were unable to really determine risk factors, so we need to be able to follow patients over a period of time to determine what are the risk factors of synthetic cannabinoid use. And by doing so, we may be able to identify other populations that are high risk for synthetic cannabinoid use and poisoning, particularly the youth. This is an interest that I think we will be endeavoring in the future. And also, again, understanding the connections between synthetic cannabinoid use and mental illness, there is lots of literature to support the psychiatric effects of synthetic cannabinoid use. So if we could understand how mental health is affected by synthetic cannabinoid use, we'd really be able to understand the pathology and the danger of what this drug can do. And that's it. Okay, so we've got a lot of research, a lot of data, and now we want to bring up an amazing harm reduction outreach worker, advocate, drug user organizer, Terrell Jones. He's the outreach and advocacy manager at the Newark Harm Reduction Educators. And so we heard a lot from this, a very research-heavy panel, but I think Terrell's going to tell us what he's been seeing on the streets and what drug users are saying for themselves.
I lost a man. Chris.
Yeah.
Good morning, everybody, and I'm glad to be here. And I hope everybody's here to hear the truth today. So, we talked about this K-2 epidemic starting in the year 2015, which is untrue. We knew about the K-2 epidemic in 2012. As we sat in a meeting with individuals from the harm reduction and the peer network meeting, individuals were talking about this new substance out in the streets. 2015, our commissioner put out this report and this thing over the news about how individuals who use K2, how they react with superhuman strength and turning over cars and things like that. False messaging, again. The seed has been planted there. And it hurts me that you know that that was a lie. That was somebody smoking PCP. But the seed has already been planted in the minds of people. We want to talk about why people are using K2 and all these psychoactive substances. Because we need to look at the part that society is playing in us. When we do outreach on 125th Street, do you know what we see? We see the devastation of what is happening with K2. When you have an individual that's homeless, mental health issues, and people walk by and throw things on them, talk down to them, dehumanize them, they have no choice but to escape those feelings on a daily basis. What part do we play to allow stigma to continually stop us from doing the work that we need to do to help somebody? Here it is, you have a young lady crying on the street because of the way people treat her. And her only way to escape is to smoke K2 because she doesn't feel it. Not alone, she's pregnant. And what is the devastation behind her and the unborn child? As I've had a conversation with somebody this morning, we don't really know the effects of what's going to happen. But you know what? It's going to be generational. It's going to have a long-term effect in our community. And we need to address that. As doing my work every day, we've come to find out that the K2 epidemic is not going anywhere. K2 now has been mixed with embalming fluid. K2 now is being mixed with crack. K2 now is the green tea mixture liquefied. And this is what we're seeing out there on the streets. We can sit here. Another thing that really hurts me is no disrespect to anybody. The individuals are tired of being guinea pigs. You come in my community, you want to do research and all of this stuff, there's no disrespect to individuals. But how does that person feel being a guinea pig, being a research project? Do people take that into consideration, how that person feels once you leave them? And this is not coming from me. This is coming from individuals in my community that I serve every day on a daily basis. We talk about criminalization of individuals, homeless people in my community. Why they smoke so much K2? Because they don't have a house to go to enjoy it. They have to sit there and rush and smoke because of law enforcement. We don't have the opportunity that other individuals have. Let's talk about those issues, why we have so many problems in our community. The racial and social injustices that there are going in my community. Let's talk about those issues. We talk about affordable housing, but who is it affordable for? They ain't affordable for my people, because we're not making $80,000-$90,000 a year for affordable housing. Let's get it real. Let's stop sugarcoating this stuff here. When we sit here and we want to talk about all these new drugs that are coming out, why are they coming out at our community?
Amen.
But here again, when it comes in our community, we are criminalized for it. Mm. We're the first ones to go to jail. This is what I see on the streets every day. I see people suffering and crying because they have no alternative. They already have a record a mile long. And then you want to talk about jobs? Mm. Who's going to hire them? You want to talk about education? How can they go to school with a record? How can they get a college degree or whatever? You want to talk about reparative? How? Not talk about that because I'm one of those persons. Yes, I have a record, and it took me a long time to be able to get a job. Everywhere I had to be fingerprinted. I was deemed a menace to society because of my former lifestyle, which would be still at times be held against me because of certain places I can't go. Nobody talks about how the drug not only affects a person and the community, but let's talk about how it affects the kids in our community. Let's talk about how it breaks up the families. See, this is a bigger picture than just people using drugs. It's bigger than that. And we need to realize that and come to grips with that. On a daily basis, I live in Hunts Point, the South Bronx, the highest rate of HIV, hepatitis C, overdoses. And this has been plaguing our community for how long? Like 45 years? Really, do I have to say anything? Because it's already documented. What we need to do, man, we need to stop stigmatizing people and start treating people with respect and look at new avenues of addressing these issues. We cannot continue to address these issues the same way because the war on drugs has failed, and we know that. The war on drugs is not a war on drugs, it's a war on communities of color. And I'm going to keep it real, those who like it don't like it. Because that's what I do, that's why people don't like me. I'm going to speak the truth. Like I said, it's hard to get up in the morning, going to work, and watching people in the street that can't even get a job, can't take care of their kids, senior citizens that are fighting every day just to put something on their plate to eat. This is a big picture, people. What part do we play in this? Do we accept all of this?
Nope.
Are we going to do anything to make changes? Because history has proved itself. We could talk about the black man and cocaine. We could talk about the Chinese and the opium. And those are the facts that stereotype, discrimination is part of the United States history when it comes to people using drugs. So I do my research, I do my homework because I know what I'm talking about. And this is the same thing that's been going on for years. From the Chinese to now to the people of color and our communities. It's hard to see a woman crying because she has nothing to eat. It's hard to see that this person wants to get off the streets and get a house to take care of themselves, and you know what? They can't have the opportunity. They're not given that opportunity. Because every time that they try to do something, their criminal record is put in front of their face. Their drug use is put in front of their face. When do we start treating people like human beings? When we start giving people the respect and dignity that they deserve, just like everybody else feels like they deserve? Why? Because they make a choice of putting something in their body makes them different from everybody else. But you can sit there and drink your alcohol in peace, and nobody gonna bother you. You okay? Let's talk about the devastating effect that alcohol is doing to you. That drink that, and you don't have a problem with it. But when somebody want to go spend some coke, do some heroin, it's a big problem then.
Choices.
You know, and this work here that I do is very hard. Because see, I have to put my personal beliefs aside. My job is to educate and help people. And the first thing I think about is the help of my community. That was a conversation that I have with people out there. How are you doing today? How is your health? When it comes to K2 and all of this stuff there, my main thing is how do you feel? Have you ever been to the hospital smoking that K2? Let's talk about why. Let me hear what you're saying about this K2, what does it do? Because I need to hear from you. You don't need to hear from me. I need to hear from you because, see, you're going to come up with the solution, not me. Because here again, I'm not going to sit there and tell you what to do because we have too many people telling people what they need to do. People should be able to make informed choices of what they want. People should make informed choices about what type of treatment that they want. They shouldn't be forced into treatment because you say so. I've been to 5 programs, all forced to all those programs, and every time I came out, I lapsed. When I came into harm reduction, being treated like a human being with some dignity and respect, and my issues were addressed, and I'm not scared to say what my issue was. I was raped as a child. And every one of those programs that I went to, they broke me down even more than what I was. Did I deserve that? And the issue was never addressed. But you can tell me to go sweep the sun off the roof. You can sit there and tell me that your guilt, you need to drop your guilt when you come back from your weekend trip. But that issue was never addressed. I got into harm reduction. When doors open, regardless of whether I lapsed or what, those doors stayed open. When I went to NA and I lapsed, I could not walk back in the doors again. Because they're talking about, oh, the drugs are talking, not you. Sometimes when the drugs are talking, the truth comes out, people.
That's right.
So this is what I see on a daily basis, the argument of what kind of treatment can I get for myself? Why am I being forced to do this when I need to do that? We need to come together and think about, it ain't about us. It is about those individuals out there that need our services. And it's their choices of what they want to do to help themselves, not us to mandate people.
That's right.
This is what I see out there every day at the OPI program. This is what I see when my team come back and we do our debriefing. These are the problems that we see, the social and injustice that is going on in our community. Nothing fair for us. And believe me, it hurts people when you have to walk out there every day to see this. When we talk about ground zero for K2, 125th Street, you need to come out there and look at the devastating effects that it had on my community out there. You're not looking at the mothers that are losing their kids because of this. You ain't looking at the individuals that families have been torn apart because of all this injustice in the community. I could go to Staten Island somewhere and get all the great help I want. But again, like I stated, the South Bronx has the highest rate of overdose for years, the highest rate of HIV for years.
Bronx is burning.
Say it again, my brother.
Bronx is burning.
And who cares? When you sit down and you talk to my community about our elected officials and government, there's mistrust. When you sit there and talk about certain service providers in our community, there's mistrust. Because it's all about the mighty dollar. And to get to the mighty dollar, what hurts me the most of that is even now infiltrating harm reduction. Harm reduction in some places is trying to be watered down because the government won't part of it. And because we want to receive money from the government, we got to do what the government says. That's just not happening in harm reduction and New York harm reduction educators. We're standing alone. We don't need the fucking government's money. We're going to stay true to the values and principles and the ideology of what harm reduction is based on. And that's being non-judgmental. That's being putting my bias to the side and looking at the welfare of the person first before mine. Putting my beliefs to the side. Treating people with dignity and respect. That's what I see is needed in my community. This is what we see that goes on. We don't have that. We are looking at it as a third world country in the South Bronx and in East Harlem. So what I'm gonna leave y'all with is what, for those that don't believe and have their own opinion, where do we go from here? Where do you go from here? Are you truly here to help people? Or are you here for yourself? Woo!
Thank you. All right. So, okay. I work with Terrell all the time, but he brought it to a new level this morning. So thank you for that, Terrell. I mean, I think we've had a wonderful array of panelists here talking a lot about a lot of different things.
And one thing that is very obvious is that novel psychoactive substances have sort of this broad classification. Even in this panel of a issue, in a summit that is already limited, there was a lot of different types of drugs mentioned, lots of different experiences, trends, demographics. And so I was wondering if the panel could speak to, what is the having sort of this broad classification of novel psychoactive substances, despite varied psychoactive properties, are there pros to that classification? Are there cons to it? Is it something that we should reconsider the way that we're sort of grouping all of these different drugs that have different outcomes and trends and users in one classification?
Good question.
Yes. Yeah. Okay, so in my dealings with it, people use these psychoactive substances for different reasons. And through conversation, some people say it calms them down, it relaxes them. It numbs the feeling of dealing with societal issues, you know what I'm saying? Not only because it's untraceable in their urine, it just takes them to another place. And these are people that are not really misusing, because you have people that can smoke K2 and all this stuff every day and have no reaction to it. But you have some individuals that have had hospitalization because they overuse it. And these are the things that we talk about, people, about the overuse of these medications, especially when we talk to individuals that are on some type of psychotropic medication, mixing of, medications and stuff like that, you know what I'm saying? But like I said, most people smoke it and don't have no adverse effect to it. They use it as somebody maybe using Tylenol, Cervical, or whatever.
So, yeah, there are hundreds of novel psychoactive drugs that have been discovered in the last 10 years. There are at least 500 of them. A lot of them have similar effects to one another. For example, like the synthetic cathinones, there are probably about 40 or 50 or more. They're similar, but what's one thing that's good about classifying all novel drugs together is, if you're a researcher, it's probably easy to get funding. Like me, I just said, I'm studying novel psychoactive drugs, and therefore, whatever new drugs come up, I could study. I'm not limited to ecstasy or methamphetamine. So I could study if there's an epidemic of synthetic cannabinoids, I could focus more on that. Or if something new pops up tomorrow, I could focus on that because of the umbrella term. So that's been beneficial to me. But I think I, as a researcher, have a responsibility that when I'm reporting about use, I also have to break it down into novel drug categories and, if possible, specific drugs. So I have a new paper coming out soon, and another new paper hopefully coming out after that, where I break down percentages. So first, I think we should say, I found about a third of New York City nightclub attendees reported using a novel psychoactive drug. But then if we break it down, what do we find? 16% said they use synthetic cannabinoids. So it's responsible to report that. About close to 10% reported using this new drug called N-bomb, which could kill people if you take the wrong dose. So it's important to look at different drug categories and the correlates of different drugs. We can classify some of these drugs together. For example, tryptamines and phenethylamines, some of them have a little bit of an overlap with regard to effects.
But one thing I am finding, and I think a lot of people would agree, that synthetic cannabinoids are a very different animal than a lot of these other novel drugs. If you're a club kid that goes out or a psychonaut, you're probably more attracted to these more psychedelic type of drugs, like the 2C series and tryptamines, things like that. Synthetic cannabinoids, completely different. Different social demographic, correlates, different reasons for use. So there are pros and cons for all of this, but these are the things that we're looking into every day.
And I think, beyond the research and sort of the classification, and I think your whack-a-mole, title was in terms of how the government wants to criminalize or make illegal these substances that change constantly, and it would be nearly impossible to, write into law. And so I wonder, with that in mind, and also how we're seeing the over-criminalization of drug use, and how is it time to sort of rethink the way that we're drug testing people, rethink the way that we're having these punitive effects for housing, for jobs, for access to social services? Is it even is there even a point if these drugs are constantly changing? You're saying that there's not even ways to detect them without these advanced testing. Why do we continue to test and punish people for something that's so hard to pin down?
If you're asking me, I think that there's multiple questions there. I mean, from my perspective in the emergency department or the hospital, I have no reason to know what drug you've used. It almost has no implication whatsoever. And the only reason we ever test anybody is for psychiatrists, because in their evaluation of patients, it does help to know whether they have what's called a dual diagnosis, meaning a substance abuse disorder along with a primary psychiatric disorder. So it doesn't really change how I manage you, because if your head says sedate you, if you're sleeping, I intubate you. We're comatose, not sleeping. We manage people based on their clinical findings, not so much based on their drugs. From an epidemiological perspective, I think it does help to know what people are taking. But again, we can't find those things in our hospital. Those have to go to advanced testing labs. Very expensive to do this kind of work. So there's no practical way we're ever going to be able to test everybody. When it comes to the social and criminal implications, it's probably a little bit beyond me to discuss that. We each have our own personal thoughts about it, but I don't really know enough about the true implications of it. I do think, though, from a regulatory perspective, the idea of banning compounds individually is probably something that should be considered to be historical. I mean, it's not really practical to wait a year or two after a new compound comes out onto the market, so to speak, to wait till we've learned enough about it to have Congress or the DEA formally ban it. Now, of course, the implication of banning it means it makes it illegal and it makes what you're doing illegal, which is a slightly different issue. From my perspective, banning it means that you can't import it from China anymore, and it shouldn't be on the street. You can turn that around to the social side of things. If I look at things a little bit more from the regulatory and sort of the marketing or the importation side of things, that's my perspective on why they're being banned so aggressively. And the whack-a-mole thing is important, because all you have to do is add a new carbon, a new hydroxyl group, a new this or a new that, and you have a brand new compound. It's no longer illegal. You can't say, let's make every compound illegal, right? Because many of these things actually have roles in life, and they are necessary. There's so many abusable substances that you use every day. Gasoline. You can't ban gasoline if somebody sniffs it one day. So we can't just do that, but we do have to take a very deliberate approach to this to try to reduce the harm that these drugs are causing.
I just have two things to say. Why testing and who's being tested?
And yeah, Michelle, I'd love to hear a little bit about, from the city's perspective, right? So we know that, there's some movement in HRA or the city's welfare system to integrate harm reduction approach so that, being a drug user doesn't automatically kick you out of the rolls. There's been a little bit of movement that you won't, violate probation or parole because you test positive for marijuana. But we still have a long way to go. And I wonder if all the research is showing that it's a lot of poverty, cost issues, that why people are using cannabis in the first place. and also wanting to avoid getting these punitive measures, is there any movement in the city to say, you know, maybe we shouldn't connect drug testing to accessing services?
Oh boy. That's probably a little bit above my pay grade and where I'm situated in the health department, but I will talk a little bit about, when we talked about these findings and really explained, okay, well, people are, many individuals were opting to use synthetic cannabinoids to avoid a positive drug test because these compounds are undetectable. The most common response that we got back was, oh, well, can we test for it? It's like, well, not really. It's incredibly expensive. There's a ton of different compounds. They're, you know, evolving all the time. And then ultimately, that's not getting to the desirable goal, which is, you know, people to be a little bit more healthy. So it presents an interesting opportunity to rethink why we drug test individuals and what we drug test them for, particularly around marijuana. There's a paper coming out of the health department, I think hopefully this week, particularly around our experiencing with synthetic cannabinoids and marijuana and drug testing as part of the probation and criminal justice system. But it's definitely time to revisit that.
Great. And I think a lot of the, particularly around the K2 or SC, I haven't heard that, I'll start using that because it's easier to say. You know, you hear a lot of, you cannot avoid the sort of interaction between poverty and homelessness, mental health issues, the overcriminalization of those communities. And so, you know, it's kind of a, I think your research, Adriana, was like, what came first, you know? And is it just, do you think that, and maybe Terrell, you can talk to this as well, is just, do you think that K2 is just another sort of mechanism for criminalization and sort of, you know, warehousing people who may not, that are already in our city's jails and our homeless shelters and now in our emergency departments?
Right, I mean, that's an interesting question. I mean, I think, again, there's so much to be known about the receptors of the synthetic cannabinoid use until we're able to follow people through a duration of time to really assess that. But personally, and from anecdotal conversations had with providers at CPEP and with other researchers, it seems that because of the accessibility of K2 and how inexpensive it is, it seems to be one of the most attractive attributes of this use. And I think it's particularly concerning also when you think about the youth and their accessibility and how inexpensive it is, and how this, I personally think that it becomes a key issue as to why people are using it. But as a conduit to trying to criminalize and put people away, I mean, I don't, perhaps, you don't know, but I think that it's indicative of the price of the drug and how accessible it is indicative of who can use it. And whether that has a correlation is yet to be determined, or at least said out loud. But.
Just to kind of come back to the history, I think Terrell's right in terms of when it started. I mean, we were seeing synthetic cannabinoids, and you remember K2 is the brand name, like Spice, the first ones that were really widely used. Now they go under hundreds of different kind of names, many of them are kind of goofy. But originally, around 2012, I bet that's about the right time, we started seeing these people coming into the emergency department. We were working with the health department to try to figure out what this was about, because, you know, all of a sudden we got these people coming in using weird drugs with weird clinical presentation. We didn't know what it was. And, you know, it takes a lot to get the government to actually ban these things. And they were being sold, you saw the picture I showed, in head shops and grocery stores and truck stops and places like that. And they were selling for $10 or $20 a hit, which was fairly expensive. And then sometime around June or July 2015, something changed. I still don't know what changed. I imagine the price dropped, the marketing changed, but the demographic that we were seeing went from sort of a club druggish kind of scene to a homeless population, and it was dramatic. And the numbers, on an average day in the shift at Bellevue, we would see 10 or 15 people in an 8 or a 12-hour shift who came in having used this stuff. And before it was dribs and drabs, the numbers were small, and suddenly it just exploded. And I still don't know why. My presumption is it broadened out, because it wasn't, the folks that we were seeing weren't paying $20 a hit to get this stuff. All right, so something about it changed. I don't know if anybody knows the answer to that, but it was a dramatic change.
So at this point, I'd love to open it up to you all to have an interaction with the panelists. So, yeah, I saw your hand up. You can
the UK, we have similar issues amongst certainly more recently. similar issues with synthetic cannabinoids, as we call them, amongst homeless populations, but more recently, predominantly because the synthetic cannabinoids really help with heroin withdrawal. Have you controlled for all of those? It's a no-brainer. It really, really helps with heroin withdrawal. So a lot of people transitioned from heroin use, didn't stop heroin use, but certainly really reduced it and went on to synthetic cannabinoids, and that's why people are using them, particularly the populations
you're
talking about.
Was everybody able to hear the question?
No.
Yeah.
No, we didn't control for that in our data collection. So when we collected our data, we did look at other, we asked if other drugs were used, but there was no, the data was a bit sparse, not everyone answered. I mean, most of them did have, did report use of other drugs, but they didn't really specify which drugs. But that's a really interesting question. We'll definitely look into that in the future, yes.
That was also something that came up in done where people are self-reporting that as well. And one of the things that we're interested in pursuing in the future is looking more about the cross-reactivity between some of the opioid receptors and the cannabinoid receptors. That does come up.
Kenneth, Matt. I just want to kind of like answer that question you put out there. The drugs, the synthetic K2 got more synthetic. They started mixing other stuff with it. It wasn't the potency, the same potency when it first came out. It's the same thing with crack cocaine. Why crack cocaine got cheaper was because they started mixing it with Ajax. Whatever they could find underneath the sink, they started mixing it and cooking it up with, which made it bigger. So the dealers could sell more and at a cheaper price, and they didn't have to use the same potency as they did at the beginning. Because at the beginning, cocaine was enormously expensive, you know? And they just used the same remedy. But I just wanted to say what Terrell said, you know, when they start making people whole in treatment, that's when you see the war on drugs start changing and turning around. You know, they just leave them half whole and put them back on the street because it's economical and financial for them to do that. But if you leave a half person outside in the street, what's gonna happen? He's only gonna resolve right back to the same thing that got him in there in the first place. And the only way you're gonna make a change when you really start caring and making a person whole. Thank you.
We have the woman in the back, and then we'll go here. Making our work.
Good morning, everyone. This is for Joseph. Yes, I've been listening to you, and you've done a lot of advertising. My question to you is, have you ever gone out to these communities and actually had a conversation with some of these people that you actually wanted, or with these potential participants that you were going to give an incentive to in exchange for a piece of their hair just for you to do the research?
I'm from that community. I've dedicated my life to serving that. Well, it's not an actual community, it's a scene. It's the nightclub scene. And as I said, you know, 15, 16 years ago, I decided to dedicate my life to researching the scene. I didn't want to become a police officer anymore, and I wanted to help these young cub kids. I retired from the scene unscathed. Some other people did, others died. others become addicts. So that's the main scene I focus on, and I dedicate my life to that, and I want to help them.
So you have one outside of the, that type of stuff.
But that's my scene, no.
Right here in the front.
Oh, yes. My name is Onajima Weed. I'm a human rights activist, and I'd like to address this and maybe get Terrell's opinion on this. We have this language that seems to be somewhat off, right? We talk about elder abuse, and there's a person involved. We talk about child abuse, and there's a child involved. Then we have this notion where we talk about drug abuse. It's like the person disappears. It's like the person, the people, the community disappears. So this brother back here talked about making a person whole in terms of treatment, but I think the picture is really bigger than that in terms of making a people whole. The question of oppression, the question of institutionalized racism, the question of the prison industrial complex and the human service complex, which is all working together where people get paid, they get jobs, and the people themselves, their conditions become worse and worse year after year. This is a human rights question. How do we bring human rights forward? How do we have the conversation about reparations or making the people whole? So the panel can certainly address it, but I would certainly want Terrell to address that question first.
Wow. Had to put me on the spot, huh? It's going to take a lot of work. And it has to be from the ground up. Because we can't trust government officials and people to lead us. It's going to take us reforming the language that we use. So I'm going to throw this out there. Again, the word addict was just used. I'm not an addict. I'm a person I used to do drugs.
There you go.
Respect me as a person. Don't stigmatize me.
Right.
Don't label me.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? I am a person first. And I made the decision what I want to do was put crack cocaine in my system. Don't demoralize for me for that. You know what I'm saying? Respect me for that. And that's where the conversation started at. We understanding and respecting people for whatever they're doing in life. Again, like I said earlier, we don't sit there and dehumanize people because they drink alcohol, because it's legal. You know what I'm saying? But because now when alcohol wasn't legal, it was all this hoopla about it, you know what I'm saying? All this, don't drink, don't do this. But the fact of the matter is that we in the United States, for the longest, have always had this stigma against people that use drugs. This is something that I stated was embedded in this society. If you take a look at other states, countries across, overseas, they moved away from that. We here are stuck on it because you know why? Capitalism. It brings money. You know what I'm saying? It's the money factor into this. And people seem to know that, but they're scared to say something about it. Because you know why? I got to be accepted.
Right.
I got to be accepted by these people. I don't want them to know that really in my heart I feel bad for the person that used drugs, but I can't say that. Because how do other people look at me? How do other people judge me? And that's what we got to get away from.
But
you got to stand up for yourself, and if you believe that people that use drugs should be treated fairly, then you need to say it. You need to stop hiding behind the wall and be who you are. That's the only way it's going to, but it also got to come from our community, because our community has accepted that.
But
as I stated, in Harlem, where we're walking down 125th Street, people of color putting their own people down because they're homeless, because they use drugs, and calling it every word in the book. And then you want to talk about why people use drugs, because they want to escape that. My own people putting me down. So it has to start from us as a community to build our own people up. And when other people see that we're not taking that, either they're going to jump on board or we're going to have a war.
And just to put on my Vocal New York hat and take off my moderator hat, I mean, I think, so we had a really powerful action on Wednesday up in Albany with Vocal New York and our self-named angry black man, and Carell, and Drug Policy Alliance. And, you know, really what we're doing is we're seeing a lot of movement now around opioids in New York State. It's wider rural or in more rural communities, and now, you know, the kind of general drug wars is rolling in. And so you have these opportunities where, you know, at Vocal in the last few years we've passed several laws to remove the bottlenecks in naloxone, to do Hep C testing, to expand access to medicated methadone and other things. And so you have this opportunity, but what we really wanted to focus on Wednesday was you can't just move forward with drug policy reform and not look back. You know, we can't not atone and repair the harms that have already happened by the failed war on drugs.
Amen.
And, you know, we're seeing movement now because, you know, the Staten Island overdose rates, the Long Island overdose rates are double, triple, whatever, quadrupling, but they still don't even touch the rates in the South Bronx, right? Mm. So that's, I think, a narrative that we really have to push, and when we're making sure that public policy is moving forward, we want to repair those harms. We want to vacate those criminal records. We want to make sure that that funding and has to be intentional and can't be dismissive of, you know, white pain and white death, because it's real, but it's to say, you know, we know this too, we've lived forward with it a long time, and now we know how harm reduction works, we know that a criminalization approach doesn't work, and let's build a pathway forward together, but repair the harm that's already been done.
Let's go right here in, yeah.
Just as a follow-up to what you're saying, was that an official lobbying event that you went to in Albany? Or what was the nature of
it? Sure, it was a response really to a package, a heroin package by the New York State Legislature that is not particularly forward-looking. I mean, there's a lot of, you know, we really want to repeal the criminal,
the criminalization of syringes. We want to, you know, we're working for supervised injection facilities in New York City. There's a lot of progressive things that we see that there's a moment for, but unfortunately the New York State Senate is still Republican led, and a lot of harm reduction education needs to happen. So it was really kind of uplifting and making sure that conversations about drug policy reform has a black and brown face, because we're the ones that are getting hit the hardest. But if people want to talk to Haya or to LaBelle or to Terrell or Fred who's here somewhere, those guys are really organizing all that work around our users.
Oh, I'm going to follow the mic, actually.
Yes, I got a lot.
I'll repeat after you.
So my question is for Joseph. Would you be willing to like run your research and go into like the real gutter and check with the people who are not usually taking into those statistics? Because like, you know, me and Terrell, we can guide you like through the hood husband. We can get your shoes really dirty. You look like you was in the mud.
Yeah, I'm willing to be involved in those studies, whether it's a co-investigator, I'm willing to contribute other, you know, we've met and we've discussed, you know, if I could help out with the Department of Health employees any way I can to interview people, which would eventually lead to services, I'll be involved. But my main focus, my main research focus is the nightclub scene. You know, all my background is from there. So I'm willing to be involved, but I'm not going to, you know, seek funding for me to go into those areas. It has nothing to do with the club scene, which is my whole background.
My,
There are plenty of people who dedicate their lives to that. Just like the heroin problem, regardless of the community, I don't focus on that. I lost my sister to heroin. I don't focus on heroin, even though I lost my sister. It's just there are other people who do that.
I'm talking about the psychoactive. I'm like, because it's there too. Like, in the back room of the Coochie Frito, they pop Molly. I mean, we talking about the back rooms as opposed to the out front club. We talking about the back rooms that nobody really know about. Go and see the people who get them funny types who thought they was getting this, but they're really getting that, where it really happens the most. I'm talking about that kind of research because it's in the realm of your grant.
Well, it actually isn't, because I'm confined to the nightclub scene, but I would love to expand eventually. But, you know, right now it's just nightclubs. That's my 5-year grant.
And perhaps, you know, maybe what this conversation is showing is that we need more researchers, we need more funding. We can't have Dr. Palomar do all the research for all the communities. And so, you know, I think that for how do we get drug users and participatory research involved, I think that's a great question, something that hopefully lots of the researchers here can help us answer.
Okay.
The next on the mic.
Hello. Hi. Bill Matthews. My question... My question is a remark wrapped up in the question. It has to do with stigma. So we're close to Washington Square Park, and I've been told last year anyhow, if you're sitting there smoking K2, the heroin users are going to ask you to move away from the odor of it.
Right.
When I do some medicine in homeless shelters, when I'm doing medical histories, I typically ask when I'm saying, do you use marijuana, do you use benzodiazepines, and I throw in now, do you use K2? And very often, the person will look at me and say, oh no. So I'm talking about stigma in a way. And it's the stigma of the cannabinoid, the SC user, within the drug community. And so I have two aspects of my question. One is to Terrell. I know you're involved with the peer network. Is the peer network looking within to see what they can do to change the stigma that these compounds have within the drug using community? And to Dr. Palomar, do you find any of this in your drug research in the...
My dissertation focused on stigma, actually.
And what I found through serving people, especially through Washington Square Park, actually, I found that stigma is a double-edged sword. So it's mostly bad. The little bit of it that's good is it does help prevent some people from using. The rest of it is bad. Stigma is so bad it leads to secretive use. It leads to miseducation or undereducation, and a whole bunch of bad things. So it's good and bad,
but mostly bad, and I'm for eliminating it. And when things are illegal, it makes the stigma even worse. And people who need help usually can't get it, largely because of the stigma. So it's generally a bad thing, and we need to get rid of it.
Yes, Bill, we are in the process of, me and Hiawatha Robert are going to come up with a training around that. You know what I'm saying? Because this is an issue that, like I said earlier, that we have this stigma inside of our community. We have this stigma inside of certain people that inject heroin, that sniff heroin, people that sniff coke or whatever. We have this thing about, because you do this, you can't hang out with me, or you're worse than whatever, you know what I'm saying? But the fact of the matter, drug is a drug, and we all use it. And we need to understand that, because your drug use is a different mind that makes you no different from the next person. So again, we are in the process of developing these trainings, you know what I'm saying? We're going to be sitting down with Norrell, you know what I'm saying? Because the peer network is getting ready to take on a whole new face, you know what I'm saying? And this is why we ask people in the harm reduction field to send their peers there, because one of the things that we strive for is personal and professional development. We strive for education, to educate our community, to break down these walls of stigma among ourselves.
Next question.
Hello, Terrell.
Both live.
My name is Cheryl Green, also KOLs. I do research for Spice K2 Books. And my question is about for supportive housing. Predominantly, most of supportive housing is entrenched in the South Bronx. And how many trainings have you guys offered supportive housing people who generate people who live in supportive housing who suffer from mental illness, and they are being overtaken by K2's cannabinoids? Have you guys reached out to them to see what kind of training services they need?
Okay, so I did do one training at the facility. And that's something that we need to do. And why it's somewhat like hard for us to get out there to do the training, because people have this misconception of what harm reduction is. And one of the funny things about it is that the Black community does not really accept harm reduction. That's a problem. But here it is, I'm a product of harm reduction, but my life has changed. When we talk about harm reduction, the first thing people think about is needles. See, we do much more than that. Case management, holistic health, you know what I'm saying? We have individuals that do psychotherapy, we do referrals, we do a lot of work, you know what I'm saying? And because of the stigma behind harm reduction in Black communities, it's hard for us to reach out and break that. But like I'm saying, we have a new team, we are under some like new guidance, we have been afforded some funding. So we are in the process of doing a lot of things that we never had the possibility of doing before. So like I said, we are under a new umbrella of doing things, and yes, that would be one of the most priority things that we want to be doing, is to get out to those places and do education. We're going to talk to people about dual diagnosis. We're going to even bring in more harm reduction.
And the rest of the, I think, the day is going to also focus particularly on harm reduction, policy intervention, so hopefully we'll continue having this conversation in other formats. I see a couple of intense hands back there, so that whole row.
Hi, so there's a bill floating around Congress right now that would legislatively schedule over 300 new novel compounds, but we all know that the chemists are basically staying ahead of whatever gets scheduled. So if you would play that out in terms of what you would anticipate the impact would be on the ground if something like that was passed.
Really quick. We'll have much more dangerous drugs come up. That's where flocka came from. That's where synthetic cannabinoids come from. I'm worried about what the new flocka will be. And these opioid replacements, I forgot the names, but some of them hundreds, thousands times more stronger than heroin, for example. I mean, a tiny dot could kill you. I mean, now these are going around. So who knows what will be next? So we're looking at a disaster.
So just so we can get a lot of questions in, let's go with the green shirt, denim jacket, and then Asha.
Go Asha.
Good morning, my name is Derek Colwell. I'm a security supervisor of a micro shelter before Washington, and I'm Washington Heights, and I supervise the ACI, which is a detox facility on 57th Street. I want to speak to the question of what happened, what changed. I believe in like early 2014, the manufacturers started flooding the streets with these brands, and they tweaked the chemical compounds, and they acted like crack dealers from the early 80s, what they did, basically. And they dropped the price down to $5. That's why the homeless community was devastated and affected by it. And at the same time the homeless communities was affected, the prisons was affected. This substance was selling in the prisons more than heroin, cocaine, weed, all together. People were selling all their property in the prisons. And they was primarily using in prison to get past detection, but both populations was devastated because the manufacturers acted like crack dealers from the 80s. So I support a ban without criminalizing the user, and I think that's the big approach that we should take.
That's what we're headed for.
I
call
what you just said on the ban on criminalization. I just want to go back to harm reduction for a minute. So I used harm reduction skill before I knew what harm reduction was. I never used K2. I did smoke marijuana before when it was real marijuana. I don't want none now because I don't trust crap they doing. I'm not doing it. I live in Rockland County, and it was really difficult for me to keep myself together up there. Once I hit the city, things got a whole lot better, and I really learned what harm reduction is, and I'm really into it. I live in the South Bronx, right in the middle of Smackin' Hood. I don't know what they're smoking, but from what I hear, because I don't be outside, but I can't hear what's going on, and I don't like it. Somebody does need, somebody should come into the community where I live, my hood, yeah, my little ghetto, and talk to them about, you know, the survey thing and, you know, getting them some help and find out what's really going on. Because that's true to the fact, you know, you guys, like after problems, but not everybody, you gotta get to the source and the reason why they're doing what they're doing, and don't just try to throw them in jail and or send them to a rehab. I'm being on a mandate, I can't do a mandate. So I had to do it my way. They say you can't do it your way. I did it my way. I had to wean myself down, and that was my harm reduction skill from the beginning. And from then on, I still do it. I still have to do it, because where I live at, it's all around me. So, you know, I hit 9 every day. Thank you.
Asha.
That's my role too. So thank you so much for this excellent panel. I'm gonna just really make a small point here to something that you said, Terrell, and I'm standing here as a black harm reductionist, and I get very nervous in crowds that are mostly not black when we make broad statements about the black community. One of the first people to ever talk about harm reduction was Dr. Troy Duster, and that was in the 1970s. His work set forward much of the work that white people did after that, including the work we do at DPA. So he's the foundation. One of the longest standing harm reduction treatment centers was in East Palo Alto, started by a black man who had been a drug user, who had been in prison, Dorsey Nunn. He did that with his partner, David Lewis, may he rest in peace. And that not only was a harm reduction facility, but it was also a facility that employed the most amount of black people in East Palo Alto. There's any number of harm reduction things that we do that are not even, like, as the sister just said, that are necessarily called harm reduction. In the 1970s, Dr. Mutulu Shakur, the stepfather of the late Tupac Shakur, did acupuncture, detox in the Bronx. I'm not saying that everybody agrees with that as the only way to go, but they were working to do harm reduction. So I just don't want it painted that my community opposes harm reduction. I think the American community in general does not understand harm reduction. And I think the people who've done the worst to perpetuate myths about drugs have been white people in power who have set forward most of the stigmas. They've been the people who've done the Partnership for Drug-Free America. They've been the people who've done This Is Your Brain on Drugs. They've been the people who've criminalized us. So if I had to blame any community, it wouldn't be mine.
DPA puts together a beautiful Black History Month drug policy, Black Drug Policy Reformers. Check it out. Shout out to Cassandra for doing that.
Who's next?
Over here and then here.
Yeah, sorry I was late for this, but I just wanted to comment a little bit on that. I mean, we've been so inundated by propaganda. I'm Siobhan Lynch. There's a bunch of different labels I can use, but one of them is survivor of the drug war. I was in Straight Inc. Back in the, well, actually Kids of New Jersey, but essentially that's Straight Inc. But I'm also a grad student in pharmacology, and I'm doing all kinds of stuff so I can be at, you know, have some kind of say in this as somebody who was harmed by this. And it's essentially these places that we put people in are in fact sponsored by government interests. The Bushes, the Reagans, they all endorse Straight Inc. So that's entirely true. It's people in power and the sort of consolidation of it. Straight Inc. was essentially trying to create the Hitler Youth of the drug war, essentially. So we need to keep sight of the fact that government is not always going to be in our best interest in some of this, and that if they do, there needs to be some kind of working with the people on the ground instead of just making policy without actually looking at the data.
Thank you. Up front?
The point about K2 having some anti-opiate withdrawal effect is very interesting. Is there anything published on that? Any published peer-reviewed data?
Does anybody?
That was
maybe
you
can make that.
One thing I would say though is I've not heard that either, particularly, but a lot of drugs are used interchangeably for other drugs, even if they don't have the same pharmacologic mechanism, right? And we've seen people take the edge off of one withdrawal using a different drug. And so it wouldn't surprise me that happens, right? But it's not the same as saying you're taking the edge off of heroin withdrawal by giving something methadone, which has clearly the same mechanism of action.
But at some sort of brain level, all these intoxicants do interact.
Well, that's not the
she's
point.
Got it.
There's a messenger 5-glutamate or metabolic 5-glutamate pathway which has attached to it the cannabis receptor as a retrograde signaling, and it's a adenylate cyclase that causes heroin withdrawal. So if you can affect adenylate cyclase through mGluR, this is very interesting, and it could possibly be used to find a non-opiate way to detoxify people from opiates.
Right, and there are other similar examples of that, like clonidine and other things that we use alternative mechanisms.
Benzos.
Well, right, there are alternative ways to do it. And I agree with you. I think it's totally worth looking into. I've not heard that specifically, but it makes sense.
So. We had a couple more. I mean, this is, thank you for that. I'm going to get just the last couple folks in. So, in the blue shirt and then right here.
Blue shirt. For the background data, at least on the opioid cannabinoid connection, it's really strong what we know from the animal data that the cannabinoid receptors actually they form dimers with the opioid receptors, and that's why opioids work so much better with cannabis, and that's why there's about a 25% drop in opioid deaths in any state that made legal cannabis. And then we also know that cannabis helps get people off heroin, and some of these synthetic cannabinoids are absolutely going to be the same thing, except they're a stronger version of pot. So in the future, some of these cannabinoids will be incredible medicines for things cannabis does now, but on the street, the ones that are the pushiest are the ones that get taken up by the communities. And I know from what I hear around the harm reduction is that people who are more into the speeds and crack type thing are the ones who really like synthetic cannabinoids more, at least certain kinds of them, because they can be really pushy. When you hold down your CB1 receptor at 100% for a couple hours, it's much more a crack type thing. But there are some of the synthetic cannabinoids that can feel more like opioids and can be used by that community as well. And I mean, it goes all the way back to William Burroughs saying this is a great way to get off. And there's also a great new version of heroin right around the corner. And that was going back 50 years ago to Junkie, and it's the same dialogues that are been repeating for, you know, the last 100 years. So there's a little bit on the opioid side.
Thank you for that. And then right up here.
You raise your hand.
Yes, just a
she ain't giving up the mic for nothing.
I know. My name is Slade Underwood. I'm a researcher with NKI. I have a quick question for Dr. Palomar. So over the years, I've been familiar with certain voluntary testing services for MDMA, such as like pillreports.org or DanceSafe. I was just curious if you had a rough estimate of how many recreational users are taking advantage of these testing services, and also like testing services at these music festivals and things of that nature, or how many samples approximately are these services receiving a year?
I can't speak for DanceSafe, and I don't think they record everything they do. But I did find that, I think about a quarter of those I surveyed outside of nightclubs said that they had at least tested. That could be once, it could be all the time, I'm not sure. But We need better testing too, because those little droplets that they use, they're reasonably effective, but they're not perfect.
Right.
So I'm actually writing a couple of grants now, and one is I'm actually hoping to somehow utilize a loophole where we're able to use possibly the Raman scanner, where we could actually scan drugs and figure out their contents, and it could scan for hundreds of different drugs. And if we don't touch the drug, maybe we can actually find what it is and use it as a loophole so we don't get arrested. Maybe the users won't get arrested. But we need research. But it's hard to get research done on testing product, drug product. That's why I'm relying on hair. I think hair is better than testing urine, because urine might hold drugs for a couple of days or a week. Same thing with blood and saliva. But hair, it could, as we found, it could stay in your hair for up to a year. So I've been relying on that, but we need drug product testing, kind of like what DamSafe has been doing. But we need to, and we need to publish results in an empirical manner.
Well, okay. So my next question is, how much is an active dose of MDMA, and how much of my drug do you need to test it?
I don't know, but when it comes to this new machine, doesn't destroy the drug. That's one.
So you're gonna send it back to me?
So it would scan it. It would be in a glass box. We don't touch it. You put it in there. It scans. You take it back a few minutes later.
You're gonna see me put it in there, right?
Uh-huh.
I said you're gonna see me put it in there, right?
Well, I'm a researcher. If I could somehow get government approval, moreover, to protect you more than me, I'm all about it. But then I need government. I need DEA approval, local Department of Health approval, probably. I need people to do it. Meanwhile, DamSafe is out there just using the liquids, doing it, but you don't have the exact results, and we're not getting the research findings we need. So I'd love to collaborate with people like DamSafe and try and get a study together, but I need funding and approval. I'm trying to lead this, but the governments might not cooperate.
Right. So I'll comment. The qualitative tests that are done on site with the drops, they give you a little bit of information. I'm not how reliable it is. We've looked at it in the past, and it's pretty good, but not great. And as the compounds get more complex, the testing's going to get less helpful. If you send it, so I've worked with xcdata.org, which is part of the Arrowwood group out in California, and if you send them the pill with a fee, because they have to afford what they're doing, it's very expensive testing, I think it's $30 or something, if they will do the test for you, they'll post it online. So the assumption is every other pill that comes that looks like the one that you sent in, that comes from the same general area of the country, is going to have the same content. They can't send it back to you. See, the interesting way it gets done is when you mail it to them, you don't know what's in it. But once they know what's in it, it's now an illegal compound. So they save it and it gets taken away by the DEA.
Right.
But so you have 10 pills, you send one. If you have one pill, I wouldn't send it.
Okay, so that's all the time we have for questions. I think this is a really rich discussion. I think for me personally, it illuminated that there's a lot that we don't know. We don't know what drugs we're taking. We don't know what's in them. We don't know the new compounds that are coming up. But what we do know is how we can take care of each other and how we can we need to work together to make people whole, to lift people out of poverty, to take away the way that we judge and stigmatize each other. And that's the foundation for how we need to move forward. So thank you all for coming bright and early. I think it's lunch next. I don't know if it's lunch or not, but
all right, so we're going to break for lunch. We're gonna-